A few preliminaries before we begin this evening. I want to remind everyone that's here to please check in with the attendance, and that, as you can see, we've revised the configuration of the room, and only authorized persons can sit within the roped-off area. There are seats and space available for the general public in the back. At this point, I'll call the meeting to order. Please shut any cell phones off. And I would ask Jane if we have, at the present time, a quorum. We need 78 members for a quorum.
Yes, we have 94.
And there is 94 currently present, so we do have a quorum to proceed. I want to go over very briefly the procedural rules. This group is familiar with the rules, but again, in summary, the rules of the meeting are determined by Vermont state law, the Brattleboro Town Charter, and Robert's Rules of Order. The charter provides that voting on all matters shall be by standing, or if you're unable to stand, by raising your hand, or by division of the town meeting members, or by roll call vote of the town meeting members. A division of the town meeting members shall be held at the discretion of the moderator or upon demand of three or more of the members. A roll call shall be had upon demand of six or more town meeting members. Now, with regard to debate, no town meeting member or voter of the town shall speak more than twice on the same question without leave of the town meeting members. Town meeting members or voters of the town who have once spoken shall not again be entitled to the floor to the exclusion of another who has not spoken. A town meeting member may not call the question immediately after speaking on the issue. Finally, in keeping with tradition and out of respect for your fellow members, I would ask you to kindly limit your remarks to not more than 2 minutes. I'm not going to be here with a stopwatch, but we undoubtedly will have a lot of people who want to be heard. Vermont law prohibits consideration of articles that have not been warned. This means you cannot take binding action under articles other business, and you can't amend or warn articles such that it would bring up business that hasn't been warned. Likewise, debate will be confined to the merits of the question. Please raise your hand to be recognized, and when recognized, you should give your name and speak directly into one of the microphones so that the viewers at home can hear your questions and your comments. This meeting is being televised by Brattleboro Community TV. It will be broadcast live on cable channel 10 and will be rebroadcast several times over the next 2 weeks. The meeting can also be watched live on your computer by going to BratteboroTV.org and checking on and clicking on Watch Channels Online, Channel 10, or you can watch the meeting on demand at the same website starting tomorrow. This meeting is being interpreted for the deaf and hard of hearing by Elizabeth Burke and Darlene Todd. Refreshments are provided this evening by the BUHS Abroad Exchange Group, and they're taking orders. And if you wish to have any sandwich or refreshments, you should put your order in now, and we will let you know when they're available. At this point, I would like to just yield for a moment to Mr. Gartenstein for a very brief announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I want to begin by just making an announcement about a personnel-related matter. We got notice very late on Friday that Police Chief Eugene Wren is retiring effective June 27th, Chief Wrynn has been with the Brattleboro Police Department for 28 years. He's been a committed public servant. We want to thank him very much for his work for the town.
And now we'll move to the business for this evening. And the chair would recognize Ms. O'Connor for a preliminary motion.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I move that the following persons be authorized to sit in the reserve section with the select board: Interim Town Manager Patrick Moreland and Town Attorney Robert Fisher.
Is there a second? Is there any discussion? Mr. Dimes?
I'm Kurt Dimes, District 2. I do not favor this procedure. Recently, I have noticed consistent violations of procedure by, I regret to say, by Mr. Fisher, and to a much lesser degree by Mr. Moreland. When seated at the panel with the select board, they consistently hogged the microphone. Mr. Fisher has spoken out of turn. And at the last meeting, he even called for your attention, like that, you know. And he addressed the crowd directly at one moment, addressed the assembly without even being recognized. You didn't catch that, unfortunately. So I think we should not allow routinely this kind of suspension of the rules.
Is there further discussion on the preliminary motion? If not, all those in favor, please rise. You may be seated. All those opposed, please rise. You may be seated. And Mr. Fisher and Mr. Moreland, you are welcome to join the meeting. The chair now recognizes Mr. Scholes for a preliminary motion. Mr. Scholes.
I move that the electronic media be permitted to remain in the reserved section.
Is there a second? It has been moved and seconded that the electronic media be permitted to remain in the reserved section. Are you ready for that question? If so, all those in favor, please rise. You may be seated. All those opposed, please rise. And the electronic media shall be permitted to sit in the reserve section. We now move to the substance of the meeting. Article 1, to see how much money the town will raise, appropriate, and expend to defray its expenses and liabilities. And the chair recognizes Mr. Gartenstein.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I move that the select board be authorized to raise, appropriate, and expend sum not to exceed $15,666,866 in order to defray to that extent all general fund expenses for the period July 1, 2014 through June 30, 2015, including all highway and Windham County taxes, and the select board be authorized to expend in addition any sum authorized for special purpose under any article contained in the warning for this meeting, the annual meeting, or any other special meeting, and interest at a rate of 1% per month be charged from the due date of payment on any overdue payment of the town tax installment or portion thereof, and that the town tax is assessed on the grand list as of April 1, 2014 shall be due and payable in four equal installments, payable to the town treasurer until overdue, then to the collector of taxes, and that such payment of the installment shall be made on or before 5 p.m. on August 15, 2014, November 17, 2014, February 17, 2015, and May 15, 2015. And I'd like an opportunity to speak to that question.
Thank you. Is there a second? It has been moved and seconded that the Select Board be authorized to raise, appropriate, and expend the sum not to exceed $15,666,866 in order to defray to that extent all general fund expenses for the period of July 1, 2014 through June 30, 2015, including all highway and Windham County taxes, and the Select Board be authorized to expend in addition any sums authorized for special purposes under any article contained in the warning for this meeting, the annual meeting, or any other special meeting, and interest at the rate of 1% per month be charged from the due date of payment on any overdue payment of the town tax, installment, or portion thereof, and that the town taxes assessed on the grand list as of April 1, 2014 shall be due and payable in four equal installments payable to the town treasurer until overdue, then to the collector of taxes, and that such payment of the installments shall be made on or before 5 p.m. August 15, 2014 and August 17, 2014 and February 17, 2015 and May 15, 2015. Mr. Gartenstein.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. As town meeting members are aware, we convened on March 22nd and adopted a budget at that time of $16,284,625. Within 10 days thereafter, petitions signed by 56 town meeting members called for a referendum on the budget article. And I believe it was April 17th that we had a referendum at which approximately 745 people voted to overturn that budget, and around 450 voted to endorse that budget as previously adopted by town meeting. Following the referendum, the Select Board has had a series of meetings to go back through the budget in order to bring a budget back to this body this evening. We began by looking at a broad set of potential changes to the budget that included both delay of, or actually removing from the budget, the interest payment for the next $9 million that we had planned on borrowing for the police fire facilities, and then looking at other structural changes that would have included personnel cuts in various departments and other cuts in services. We had a series of meetings that I think many of you had the opportunity to attend. One of them was here. And we heard many people opposed to really any cuts in services being made by the Select Board in reformulating this budget. As a result, we took a different approach from cutting services and cutting personnel, which is really the only way to cut services, and instead requested again what we had requested in the last development of the budget, which was a series of 1% cuts across the board. And at a meeting approximately 3 weeks ago, I believe, we went through each and every one of the 1% cuts, or all the components of those proposed 1% cuts that had been generated and I don't want to say recommended, but at least itemized for us by the department heads. As a result, we have adopted a series of cuts from the prior $16,284,000 budget as follows. We've removed $261,473, which is the interest that would have been paid this year on the next $9 million in borrowing for the police fire facility. We've cut $50,000 from capital budget for improvements to sidewalks,
We made that cut recognizing that there's $50,000 being carried over from last year in sidewalk improvement funds, and that there's grant money available that we hope to be spent this year, maybe next, but hopefully this year, to rebuild the sidewalks on the east side of Main Street. We also cut one police cruiser from the capital budget. We have a 2-cruiser-a-year replacement cycle, and this knocks us off that cycle. We'll be replacing just one cruiser this year if this budget is adopted. We also then went through all of these 1% cuts that had been listed by the various department heads, and we made a series of those and adopted a series of those as follows and as shown on the handout that's in the back. $1,805 from the town clerk for improvements to and maintenance of the land records. $1,500 in cost savings on preparing the town report. $1,250 cut from the legal notices and postage line at planning. $6,185 from the library budget, which represented cuts in telephone because we're getting cheaper services through the Vermont Department of Libraries E-rate discount, and reduced budget for office equipment, conferences, training, mileage, and special programs. We cut $18,311 from the fire department, which was bringing the budget actually even closer to actual based upon some changed personnel changes that we anticipate over the course of the next budget year. $19,308 in cuts in the police department included reducing the animal control officer position from 40 hours to 30 hours weekly. We cut $2,000 in propane and cemetery maintenance from Parks and Recs. Those cuts came in total to $402,759. It's my personal perspective, having been through all of this, that any additional cuts would result in cuts in staff positions. I can't say that all select board members agree with that, but I don't know where other cuts would be made. There were things that we could not agree to cut out of the budget, even though they were within the 1% list. They included some further cuts to salary, for example, in planning. We had already made, the Lister's office. We had already made cuts to salary in the Lister's office, and those employees already are being forced to take furlough days next year as a result of the cuts we made leading to the budget presented in March. One of the proposed cuts in the Department of Public Works was to eliminate line striping and to remove a piece of safety equipment, a radar detector that we had decided to add to the budget. Given the traffic safety issues that we deal with in town, we decided that twice a year line striping and having that safety equipment was something that was necessary, and we weren't willing to cut that money out of the budget. Similarly, we could have cut some money out of central dispatch budget, but they are already functioning right at bare minimum staffing. And so these were the cuts that a majority of the board was prepared to agree to, $402,759, which brings the budget to $15,881,866 approximately. Now, then we continued with a discussion about the potential for taking funds from the unassigned fund balance to offset expenses and to lower our taxes. We had an article on the warning at the March meeting, and that was defeated by town meeting at the time. We got some good news from the finance director indicating that even after we pay for some unanticipated expenses from last year, unanticipated expenses included the flooding on September 11th that washed out Elm Street and the bridge, or the road leading to the bridge, that the unanticipated expenses from moving our communications equipment from the top of Wantosticket to the hospital tower and to the ski jump tower. Even after paying that money, we anticipate that we should have about $200,000 surplus this year. Now, that $200,000 surplus comes from our having taxed ourselves this current year for borrowing the entire $14 million for the police fire facility. We only borrowed $5 million, so we raised about $200,000 additional revenue. And so what we decided to do was to leave the surplus essentially at $1.6, $1.7 million and to turn $200,000 anticipated surplus to defray the costs that we're going to incur this coming year, which then brings the proposed budget that's presented to you tonight to the number in the motion, 15,666,866. We're available to answer any questions you may have.
Is there further discussion with regard to the motion? Yes, ma'am.
Prudence McKinney, District 1. I just wonder if you can explain for a minute about the sidewalk money. Was the $50,000 that was cut intended for the sidewalks that are going to go ahead with other funds, or in fact, is that a reduction in the either maintenance or building of sidewalks in Brattleboro?
I would ask Mr. Barrett to confirm, but generally, we ask for a certain amount of money. They ask for a certain amount, and we approve a certain amount of money for capital expenses, sidewalk and roads, and then we look at the needs and then make decision about how to proceed as we come to the beginning of the fiscal year. Mr. Barrett?
Good evening, Steve Barrett, Director of Public Works. That will be a cut in the actual replacement of sidewalk. Each year we try to do approximately $50,000 worth of capital upgrades to improve sidewalks. We have about 38 miles. Last year we did not do a capital project, but it still could have been done this spring. And so we're deferring some of that work.
Ms. McKinney, do you have a follow-up part of the same question?
I just want to speak in opposition to cutting funds for sidewalks. I think that the town infrastructure is extremely important, and having walkable streets and walkable neighborhoods is a priority, and so I'm just speaking in favor of sidewalks. Thank you.
Further discussion on the motion? Over here.
John Wilmerding, 2nd District. Just a point of clarification, please. You mentioned that the cuts include the anticipated interest on the second police fire project bond. What administrative guidance has been given by the Select Board or other parties to the Police Fire Project Oversight Committee in that regard?
We have recognized, I think, as a select board, that significant decisions need to be made about what's going to happen to the police fire facilities renovation project, but that we don't have the answers yet, and that process needs to unfold going forward. And as a result, we decided to defer borrowing the additional $9 million. We have asked the police fire renovations project committee to begin looking at alternatives. They have proposed some additional alternatives to us that range from around $5, $6, $7 million through $12 or $13 million. And we anticipate once this budget process is concluded that we will take up again what's gonna happen to the police fire facilities renovation work as another full process going forward.
Based upon Mr. Gartenstein's explanation, it would appear to the chair that any discussion this evening with regard to the fire police capital project to be out of order. I'm saying that only as a preliminary matter, given the fact that it has been removed from the budget and the select board apparently has it under further consideration, and it will be back for us again. So, further discussion on the motion. Ms. Davison.
Judy Davidson, District 3. I just have a question again about the sidewalks. I understand where the motion is to, or the budget is to cut $50,000, but my question to Steve Barrett is, will there be money in the budget to do some sidewalk repairs this year, and how much would that be?
Steve Barrett. As Chairman Gardenstein had indicated, there is $50,000 still for sidewalk improvements, and we have also a grant for Main Street to do the east side, which is a pretty large grant. And in addition to that, there's $10,000 in the regular budget for repairs. So there will be some work done this year.
Further discussion? Mr. Siegel.
Thank you. Haim Siegel, District 3. I have an arithmetic problem. If I look at the original budget that we passed in March, $16,284,625, and subtract $602,759, I come up with, just to make sure I don't blow it here, $15,681,866. Which is $20,000 more than is in the article.
Is there a member of the administration that can respond to Mr. Siegel's inquiry?
I hope Mr. O'Connor can talk to the math answer.
The it's a $200,000 difference, and that's the amount that David talked about taking out of the unassigned fund balance. That was not a reduction in expenses.
I'm still lost. The okay, yeah, you're right. I got that part. But even if you take out $200,000 from what I just had, $15,681,866, it comes out to I'm totally lost. If you can't end up with a 680, 15, 6,000, 681,000, an amount that's $200,000 less than the 15881 that's on this sheet, which would be 15681, in order for the arithmetic to work, if you're just taking out another 200,000.
I'm not sure I'm understanding that one.
It's okay. If you go on the sheet here that we were the budget increase reduction sheet.
Yep.
And we've got where the total budgeted FY 2015. Expenditures, a proposed 15,881,866. Then you subtract 200,000 from that. That would be 15,681,866, not 15,666,866. I think there's a $20,000 error there somewhere. You can't subtract an even 200 from 800 and come up with something other than the same numbers after the 800.
Okay, let me look at that, and I'll try to understand that and try to get you an answer.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks. Further discussion on the motion. Mr. Dimes.
Kurt Dimes, District 2. I object to the opinion of the moderator that the police fire project has no place in this discussion. I also believe that if that were a term of the agenda, it should have been in the warning. The police fire project can bear and does bear on the budget, besides with respect to the interest that's been removed. There is a some $4 million that we have that are assigned to that project, which can be used to affect the budget. And the discussion of this could proceed without even discussing the merits of the project. So I object, and I think it's highly improper to restrict the discussion that way.
Mr. Dimes, I'll attempt to respond to the issues that you've raised. Certainly the $4 million part of the project for which there is included within the budget debt service is something we can discuss because it's part of the budget. However, I take the position that I do with regard to the actual police fire capital project as we know it, that it is out of order for tonight's purpose because it has been removed from the budget. And it has been removed from the budget so that the select board can continue their deliberations. Now, let me say to you that specifically under our charter, the Brattleboro Charter, it provides that no capital expenditures by the town can be made without first being submitted to without prior consideration by the select board. The select board has not concluded, according to Mr. Gartenstein, their consideration. So that's a long-winded way for me to say that it is not germane for this evening's meeting. You are always welcome, should you wish to discuss it, to appeal the decision of the moderator, but that's my reading of the law and of the rules. Sure.
Do I understand then that the discussion of the remaining portion of the bond, which has already been withdrawn, the discussion of those proceeds and how they may affect the budget is still germane?
That is still a part of the budget, the $4 million for which there is within the budget a debt service figure. Okay. Is part of the budget, so it would be germane.
Thank you. Then I wish to make a motion on that later. Thank you.
Okay. Further discussion with regard to the pending motion. Yes.
I'm Tom Fennell from District 2, and I'd like to express my gratitude for the board for working hard trying to minimize the expenses to the town while minimizing the pain to everybody. And I recognize the fact that no matter what we do, there will be some pain to some. And I would like to try and make sure that those who can least afford that pain are spared from it somewhat. Now, I'm from District 2. I live on Elliott Street. And if you notice, Elliott Street's not a part of the town that's noted for its big, wide, well-manicured lawns and two- or three-car garages. Typical house on Elliott Street could probably be described as some kind of an apartment house. Some very small, some very big, but there's at least almost every house there has rooms or apartments that they rent. I've spoken to several people who typify to me the owners of these houses, and they seem to all fit the same pattern. They're relatively older people who bought their houses a long, long time ago. They're retired now. They're making their survival living, if you can call it that, by living in the house themselves and renting out apartments. And the effect of an increase in property tax on these people would probably be disastrous for some of them. I know one guy was really telling me, he's in his 80s, he's talking about having to go out and get another job. And I would like to see that we try and scrape the barrel a little bit closer so that we can keep the property taxes from rising. Now, it's not my part here to suggest what they are. We've got commissions and committees for that. But I think we should look as close as possible as to keeping those keeping our tax rises to the minimum. Basically, I'd just like to say, to benefit these people, and there's a considerable number of these people, this budget can't pass. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional questions? Ms. King.
Mary Kane, District 1. I just have a couple questions. I'm a little confused, so please help me understand this. If we don't have a town manager, is that salary in this budget? And if we have no animal control officer since February, is that in this budget? And since Police Chief Wren is retiring, does that mean that his salary now is at loop? And also, can you please explain to me how certain salaries are divided and hidden in each department, which would seem a little difficult to follow if you didn't know the total salary that individuals are getting? So if you could please address those issues, because that now we don't really have a static budget, because we know that there are there's a committee that is searching for a town manager, and that wouldn't be in the budget, correct? So even if we pass this budget, I'm a little confused, wouldn't it be different next year at the end of the year? Because the figures wouldn't add up?
Is there someone within the administration that could address Ms. Kane's inquiry?
In planning the budget, building the budget this year, we include salary for all the personnel we expect to be working over the course of the year. So we have in the fiscal year 15 budget, salary for a town manager and assistant town manager, salary for a police chief, salary for an animal control officer at 30 hours. We have salary for all the employees who work for the town, although there's been some cuts as a result of the budget that we adopted or that we presented in March, and then for this budget as well. So all the people that we expect to be working over the course of fiscal year 15, we've budgeted for paying their salaries and their benefits. Now, there are some people, some positions that have not been filled fully over the course of this year. For example, we've had an interim town manager since July, but we haven't then had an assistant town manager. So there's about, there's that salary's worth of savings in the surplus that we anticipate at the end of this year. Similarly, there's been a position at the police department that's been vacant for a period of time. So to the extent that salary hasn't been paid for that, that money hasn't been expended out of the FY14 budget. And at the end of the year, barring any unforeseen expenses, that would show up as surplus at the end of the year.
So I just have one more question.
Please.
Could you please explain to me then, if you have those parameters, how is it that you automatically put into place the overtime that you expect? Is it not possible to say there will be no overtime, unless barring a severe disaster like Irene? I'm a little confused.
In a business that's got 120 employees, with various tasks that have to be done at odd hours, from time to time there's overtime. And we are working to the extent possible to minimize overtime. We raise that issue in the budget process with department heads and with the interim town manager. And when there's a full-time manager, we will continue to focus on that issue. But at this point, barring hiring additional full-time employees, there's some overtime that's built into the budget. And these figures that are included in the budget for overtime are essentially the department heads and the town manager's best estimate of what the overtime expenses are likely to be this coming year based upon previous year's experience.
Thank you very much. I do suggest, though, that this budget not be passed.
Further discussion on the motion. Mr. Fennell. Yes, please. Mr. Fallon. Mr. Fallon, sorry.
You already spoken.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Peter Fallian, District 3. I have a budget planning question. I'm wondering what attention, if any, has been paid to developing multi-year budgets. A comprehensive one, of course, for the year that we're discussing, but out-year budgets, too, so that this body and others can anticipate questions and anticipate what you expect will be financial liabilities.
Multi-year budgeting has certainly been discussed. The Finance Committee has raised the issue from time to time. The capital plan is an example of a multi-year budget that is disregarded every year because we always cut the capital budget in order to save money. So we've got huge volumes of necessary capital expenses that aren't being tended to because we don't have enough money every year. I guess it is possible to do multi-year budgeting with respect to the operating budget as well. It's not the way in which budgeting has been done ever in town, and it's something to be looked at, but with only one of two people in the town manager's office, it's not a step that we've gotten to at this point, but we've certainly talked about it and talked about other ways to look at structural issues in the budgets.
Thank you. If Mr. Moderator, if I might just follow up, if I could.
Yes, go ahead.
And that is that I truly believe we have a structural budget problem in the town, and we've had it for many, many, many years. And I just want to bring some of the older representatives' attention back to what Dart Everett said here many, many years ago in this body, that we have a problem because the property owners are shouldering the town's budget, and our commercial side of things is stagnant. At least it's not developing at a robust rate. So my suggestion would be to follow on that suggestion written in the Commons recently by the, I believe he's the president of the Brattleboro Area Savings and Loan, when he said that the town should engage the principal organizations in town that are charged with economic development, such as the Chamber and the Development Corporation and Southern Vermont Development, to help us that way. Because until we generate more cash on the commercial side of things, we're just going to be in this situation, I believe, and ongoing. I think we need to pay attention to that moving forward. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Further discussion? Mr. Montgomery.
Tad Montgomery, District 2. As part of the police and fire facility project, it came out that the municipal building is out of compliance, and the estimates that I've heard for bringing it into a compliance are over $400,000. Is that money in this budget?
There's a quick answer. I believe there's a member of the administration that can respond. Ms. O'Connor.
The easy answer is no, it has not been budgeted in this budget.
Does that work need to be done before the end of fiscal year 2015?
No, it doesn't have to be done by the end of the next fiscal year, but we're getting a plan in place.
Okay, thank you.
I think it's Ms. Grover, is it?
Hi, Judy Grover, District 2. I just have a couple of questions. If we have taken all the money that this town has spent on feasibility studies for the police and fire, we would have paid for this building. Now, has anyone even looked at any of the other suggestions? And how could we possibly have paid a company to go into the municipal center and we not know that all those things had to be addressed? How could this be missed with the amount of money spent? This town plans a project, and before it's completed, the select board changes. Then we end up with a whole new group of people with a whole new group of priorities. We really have to build something into our budget that says, This is the project, and it has to be completed. Because we've done feasibility studies. Kate should remember. Her mother did them. Dart Everett did them. Has anyone even looked at them? I mean, I understand the library was built to house a third floor for the police station. Is that still a viable thing to do? I mean, it's like the police and fire must think we're all against them, and that's not a true statement. It's the Board of Selectmen that cannot complete a project.
Further comment or discussion on the motion on the budget? Are you ready for the question? Mr. Dimes.
I move that we authorize the select board to redirect funds from the police fire facilities bond to pay account number 0162271, bonds and notes totaling $1,331,977, and to direct $500,000 of the unassigned fund balance to further reduce the budget to $14,549,889. This figure would be right in the middle between the levels of the budgets of 2013 and 2014. It would allow all the planning of the board to stay in place. The budget that you have worked out in the past several months, including the modifications in the last several weeks, would be intact, and the money that you need for it would be lowered by some $1,800,000.
Mr. Dimes, before you speak, I'll allow you to speak on the motion, but before you do, two things. One, do you have a copy of the motion that I can look at, because I need to take a look at it,
sure.
Restate it, and the amendment, rather, and then it will also need a second before we go any further, okay? Mr. Dimes, the motion that you just made, because I started writing it down and then I lost you, begins, I move to authorize, I'm not sure where it starts, right?
Shall I approach?
Yeah, you, please. So the motion is, I move to authorize the select board to redirect funds from the police fire facilities bond to pay account number 0162271 bonds and notes totaling $1,331,977 and to direct. And then there's a dollar sign, Mr. Dimes. What does that mean?
$500,000.
Oh, direct $500,000 of the unassigned fund balance to further reduce the budget to $14,549,889. You have actually a couple of concepts here. The first concept that you raise to redirect funds from the police fire facility bond to pay account number so-and-so totaling $1,331,977, I have to rule out of order, Mr. Dimes.
And the reason is it is not germane to the motion. It hasn't been warned. And it raises a subject matter which has not been a part of the warning for the general public and the members, the representatives, to consider prior to today. So that portion I have to rule out of order as not germane. I also have, Mr. Dimes, a serious concern as to whether or not we could legally, even if I said, fine, let's do it, whether we could legally do that. And for that question, what I would like to do is refer to Mr. Fisher as to whether we could even legally do what you're proposing. Yes, Mr. Phillips.
We have a motion on the floor. There was no motion to amend anything. This was just something.
I believe he did move to amend, and it was seconded.
Didn't hear the word amend in any of the wording that he read or that you read.
Well, he says motion to move to authorize the. He says move to authorize the select board to redirect funds. I would take that, Mr. Phillips. I think your point is well taken, but I still would take that as effectively a request by Mr. Dimes to have the budget amended accordingly. Am I correct on that, Mr. Dimes?
That part I didn't hear, though.
I think this is, we could proceed with it anyway. What's the right answer that keeps the discussion going?
Amend.
Amend, then.
Okay.
And I could speak also briefly to the legality. I have discussed this matter with the state bond bank director, Bob Giroux. He says it's okay. I've discussed it with the eminent attorney, Paul Gillies, who has advised this body on charter revisions. And I've even discussed it with Mr. O'Connor. And he can tell you this is a normal kind of thing.
If it were properly warned, I would agree. However, it was not, and it's not germane. However, I want to hear whether or not it's even legal. Mr. Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. With regard to what we're talking about here, are unexpended bond proceeds, and under the statute, they can only be used really for three main purposes. One can be to enhance a project. For instance, if you finished a project and you had $20,000 left over and you wanted to carpet a certain room, you could use it for such an enhancement. Second, you can go back to the voters at a specifically warned meeting for that purpose to get the approval to spend the money on another capital project. You cannot use that to pay debt service, which is what the motion to amend calls for.
So, but the debt service is for capital expenses. We have incurred those debts for capital expenses.
That is correct, but it's debt service for which you are paying, not the capital expenditures.
All right. That doesn't make a lot of sense. If you're paying off the debt service for the capital expense, that's definitely related to capital expense. And as I said, Mr. O'Connor can tell you this is a normal procedure, and Mr. Giroux, the state bond bank director, agrees.
Do you have anything to add, Mr. Fisher?
Nothing further with regard to
I based upon my first ruling, have to rule it out of order as not germane to the question. It hasn't been properly warned. However, you have two separate motions in one, because then the second piece of your motion goes on to say, and to direct $500,000 of the unassigned fund balance to further reduce the budget to 14,549,889. You are at liberty, Mr. Dimes, to make such that part of your motion. But I am going to rule the first part out of order. Now,
If you wish to appeal my decision to this body, you can, but that's
yes,
my
sir.
Rule.
Yes, sir. I think this is a very grave interest to the body, and we deserve some flexibility in discussing it so forth. So I ask for an override,
okay,
if that's the proper procedure.
Right. It's essentially, Mr. Dimes has requested an appeal of my determination, of the chair's determination, that the motion as it is currently framed is not germane and is out of order. So he has appealed my decision. Is there a second to that appeal? Mr. Fennell seconded it. Is there discussion about whether or not, any discussion about whether or not his motion is or is not germane? Hearing none. Oh, yes, Mr. Franks.
Tom Franks, District 3. I usually like to get my legal advice from people who are in front of me and not secondhand hearsay. I would strongly oppose this motion. We have heard from our moderator. It is also,
You really do need to address the chair. Chair, Mr.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, I'm going to make you do a 360.
Do I have to look at you again? Sorry.
Thanks,
we have a process whereby we warn substantive articles. This has not been warned. I think we have no sense upon what the population wants. We have heard from the attorney that it is not an appropriate use, and I understand that it would be like borrowing money to pay. It's like kiting your credit cards. You get one credit card to pay another credit card bill. It is not good fiscal practice, even though a substantial portion of our population does it. I certainly would not support it for our town. So I rise to speak strongly against this motion. Thank you.
Okay. The question is, shall the moderators, the chairs, position, ruling, be sustained? Is there further debate on that question? Mr. Davis.
I'm just going to speak from Andrew Davis, District 3. I'm just going to speak from my own common sense. I would support your decision and say that we not get into this because it seems like a way to abandon a much needed project in this town without properly warning it. Both bonds have actually been approved by this body at one point. The select board has been very honest, and I thank Mr. Gartenstein for saying that once we get through our budget decision, police fire is right smack dab back on the table. And it's not going to be easy. But this seems to me to be a sideshow to try to short circuit what is trying to be reasonable people getting through a difficult time. And I would be completely against short circuiting the work that's been done on a much needed project that's going to take more discussion by the town of Brattleboro in this manner. This common sense to me does not feel like the way to make a decision on such an important infrastructure question. So I would support your decision, and I thank the select board for being clear that the police fire has got to be rediscussed, but this is not the time to short circuit that decision. Thank you.
Is there further discussion on the appeal of the chair's decision? Ms. Russell.
Lynn Russell from District 1. I want to thank the board for your diligence and your commitment to the town, though we have disagreed very strongly on many matters. I appreciate your character, your diligence, and the hard work that you've put into this budget At the same time, the constituents of District 1 unanimously oppose a $15.8 million budget because we can't afford it. And they've asked that the budget passed for 2015 remain the same as the budget for 2014, which we already are living with, and it's been said there's going to be an overrun or carryover or something. It sounds to me from Mr. Dimes' suggestion that those funds that are somewhere in other places that could be used to reduce this current budget with this amendment would bring the 2015 budget to an area where the constituents of District 1 feel like we can live with it. So I would appeal to the body to think about the people in town who have less financial means and resources at hand who are being asked to carry much of the burden of the budget. Thank you.
Again, Mr. Borofsky. Yes. Mr. Borofsky's point of order is correct. The issue is the appeal of the chair's decision with regard to Mr. Dimes' motion. And let's limit ourselves to that issue. It's just this one issue, Ms. Russell.
Lynn Russell again from District 1. I forgot to say that it sounds to me that Mr. Dimes did research the advisability or feasibility of such a move by contacting the state bondsman as well as other people in the world of finance. And I would encourage the body to consider supporting his research. Is that better?
And overturning the
and overriding your decision. Thank you.
Ms. Melton.
Sorry. Paula Melton, District 1. Before we decide about the appeal, I guess I would just like to hear a very brief explanation from the Select Board about the process that is planned for moving forward with the project that's under discussion. And
that would not be germane to the, unfortunately, Ms. Melton, that's not germane to the question.
It's just hard to decide without knowing. Can I have a point of information?
Yes.
Okay.
Point of information
will
takes priority.
Will there be further opportunities for transparency and citizen involvement more than there have been up to this point?
With regard to the fire police project?
I think it's fair to say that the citizens will be involved. To say that it will be more transparent is difficult because the project has been fully transparent to this point.
The question is on the appeal by Mr. Dimes of the chair's ruling his proposed amendment out of order. Mr. Mima?
Ralph Mima, District 3. I just have a question of procedure here. So if the appeal is sustained, does that simply put Mr. Dimes' motion back on the floor, or does it actually pass Mr. Dimes' motion?
No, that's a very good question. So that everybody understands what the vote is. If you, the question will be as follows. All of those, and this is not, I'm just going to tell you what the question is. All those in favor of sustaining the ruling of the chair, if you vote yay, that will mean that you are ruling that Mr. Dimes' motion is out of order, not germane, and we return to the main motion. If you vote both, the whole motion at this point. If you vote nay, then you're voting to support Mr. Dimes in his effort to present this motion as an amendment. And it requires only, to sustain the chair's position only requires a 50% vote. Now, do I hear, Mr. Wilmerding?
John Wilmer, District. I believe the moderator's decision is correct, and that I'd like to call attention of the body to the fact that when we approved the police fire project in October 2012, there was a special representative town meeting called expressly for that purpose. In the Finance Committee, we've done a great deal of deliberation and have communicated with the town manager and the select board about the capital planning for the town and how well we plan out and how far out we plan major capital expenditures. There's no doubt here in anybody's mind, I don't think, that this is a major capital expenditure and it deserves a fair hearing of its own.
Further discussion on the appeal. Mr. Borofsky. All those in favor of ceasing debate on the question of the appeal, please rise.
I ask for a division.
And there has been a division requested, and the division, be seated and we'll do the division here in just a sec. Who do we have as counters? Okay. Okay. No, I understand that. Okay, so there is there's been a division requested on suspending debate on the appeal. So all those in favor of suspending debate on the appeal, please rise and remain standing while you are counted. You may be seated. All those opposed to suspending debate, please rise and remain counted. This is on, remain standing until we count you. To suspend debate, you need a two-thirds. You may be seated. Thank you. To suspend debate, you need a two-thirds vote. 104 in favor of suspending debate, 18 opposed, and you have attained the two-thirds, and debate is suspended. So we're going to now return to the question, which is with regard to Mr. Dimes' motion to amend. All those in favor of sustaining the ruling of the chair, please rise and remain standing. You may be seated. All those opposed to the ruling of the chair, please rise. You may be seated. The ayes appear to have it, and the ayes do have it, and the ruling of the chair has been upheld. We now, thank you. Oh, I have good news. Your sandwiches are ready. anyone that ordered a sandwich at your convenience, you can pick them up. We now return to the original motion on the budget, and that is to, in abbreviated form, yes, Mr. Moreland. Point of order? Go ahead.
Thank you, sir. I was wondering if I might respond to Mr. Siegel's question about the budget numbers presented here this evening.
Oh, yeah, sure. By all means.
Is that all right? Okay. I thought it might be useful to bring a computer today, and that proved to be a good decision. I will do my best to try and help answer your question. Bear with me, and please, if you wouldn't mind, looking at the front page here.
Point of order. Mr. Dimes, point of order.
Pardon me, Mr. Moreland. Should not the discussion return to the second half of the proposed amendment about the moving the fund balance?
No, I said to you that that portion would be in order. If you wish to make that motion with just that portion, I will definitely entertain that. But it needs to be made by you just with that
separately.
Separate. That's correct.
Thank you.
In the meantime, Mr. Moreland is appropriately responding to a question that has been previously made.
Thank you.
Mr. Moreland.
Thank you, sir. So I'd like to draw your attention to the fiscal 2015 budget increase and reductions sheet, and actually to the lower half of that sheet. If you'll see on the left-hand side, the previous figure for the budget that was approved by this body back in March was $16,284,625. Now, there is a column of numbers just above and to the right of that, which totals $602,759. And Mr. Siegel is correct in that if you subtract $602,759 from the previous budget, you do not add, you do not arrive at $15,881,866. And the reason is that that $602,759 is not the number used to determine the next budget. Rather, the $602,759 is the number we use to establish what would be the reduced tax levy. The tax levy, of course, being the sum necessary to raise for property taxes. So if you see just below the $16 million figure in the budget that was previously passed, there was a tax levy of $14,076,434. If you reduce the tax levy by $602,759, you arrive at a new tax levy at $13,473,675. The reason that this number was calculated is that that then allows you to show, as John has in the lower half of this memo, what the tax implications would be for a $100,000 house, a $150,000 house, and so on. So that figure of $602,759 is not useful in helping to arrive at the $15,881,866. It's actually useful in arriving at what is the reduced tax levy. Is that helpful?
Hi, I'm Siegel, District 3. I think I understand what you're saying, but I'm confused still that the that why would the taking $602,759 out of the original proposed budget or originally passed budget, why would that end up with a different tax levy number than You know, why isn't the budget and the tax levy the same?
Can I continue?
Please.
The budget and the tax levy are different because revenue for the town is made up of more than just property taxes. And the tax levy is the property tax portion. It's the vast majority of our revenue, but it's not the entirety of the revenue. Uh-huh. So another way to look at this is if you look at the column of numbers in the upper half of the sheet, all of them but the last one total $402,759, and that is the difference between the two budget numbers. If you add the $200,000, which is the use of fund balance, you get to $602,759, and that's the number used to reduce the tax levy, allowing us to establish the numbers in the lower half.
Wait a minute. No. We need to let one person talk at a time. Thank you.
So where are we getting the 15666 866 that we're supposed to vote on?
That is a good second question. And if I may answer it. The budget being put forward in front of you tonight is 15,881,866. However, in the motion, there is a separate number, which is 15,666,866. The difference between those two numbers are a series of expenses previously passed at the March town meeting and include select board salaries that were passed separate to the budget, the downtown improvement district, climate protection, and the human services programs. Together, they reduce the 15,881,866 budget down to the motion of 15,666,866.
Gotcha. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Further discussion on the main motion, which in abbreviated form is to authorize the select board be authorized to raise, appropriate, and expend the sum not to exceed $15,666,866. Is there further discussion? Mr. Dimes.
I move, like in the second half of that earlier proposal, but that we, I think we should pause for a moment here and put what we're up to in a perspective. Although Mr. Gartenstein did mention the history, I think it sometimes goes over our heads. The same budget we have now, is not a significant reduction from what we had a couple months ago. It was approximately 16 million. Now it's around 16 million. And there was a referendum of the people, which Mr. Gartenstein recognized was, to a large degree, a vote against the police fire project, but it was also generally an outcry against increased expenses. The budget has gone up $1,600,000 since last year, and now it's still going to go up, you know, over $1 million. This does not address the concerns of the people who voted for the referendum. The people will be very disappointed and dishonored if we return a budget not significantly changed from this 15.8. So I think the only way to reduce the budget significantly is to really rack our brains and come up with something new, like what we can't talk about, or like using more of the unassigned fund balance, which is for emergencies. Now, we are on the edge of an emergency, fiscally speaking, and we should use that fund, the unassigned.
There's a point of order, Mr. Dimes. Yes.
Sherry Manning, District 1. I thought we were in discussion on the motion on the floor, and I haven't heard another motion. I hear Mr. Dimes arguing to put up another motion, but I would like to continue. Isn't it true that we're supposed to be talking about the motion on the floor right now?
Yes, we are, and I think that Mr. Dimes is going to make one, but and I hope
he... Well, it's been over 2 minutes, and he's
right,
been talking quite
again,
a lot.
Again, Mr. So. Dimes, if
you did you really time it?
If you could try to keep within the two-minute general and...
All right, let's say okay. 1 minute left. Okay. Well, who started a watch?
No. Please, okay. If you could wrap it up, Mr. Dimes.
Anyway, we are challenged with reducing the budget, and it hasn't happened. It hasn't happened. We were at 14.6 a month or so ago. Now we're at 15.8. We have an obligation to the public to reduce the budget significantly. The only way we can do that now is by using the unassigned fund balance. So I suggest we use the $900,000 of that and bring the budget down significantly.
I heard suggest.
So I move to amend the budget accordingly.
You move to, let me make sure I understand your motion. Your motion would be to amend the budget by reducing it, by transferring $900,000 from the unassigned
fund balance, yeah.
Reserve. Is that correct?
Yeah, you've got it written there. I think the public would be marginally happy with that.
Mr. Fisher.
Rather than use the word transferring, I believe appropriate from the fund balance is a
appropriate
legally more proper term.
Okay. So we're trying to in fairness to you, Mr. Dimes, we're trying to make it so that it's a germane and appropriate motion.
Thank you, Councillor Fisher.
So it's appropriate, so it's going to be appropriate $900,000 from the undesignated reserve fund. Is there a second? There is the amendment is?
Point of order.
Point of order, Mr. Underhill.
Ben Underhill, District 1. Is the $900,000 actually $700,000 above the $200,000? Or is he asking for $900,000 plus the $200,000, making it?
Would you clarify what your intention is, Mr. Dimes?
A total figure of $900,000.
Okay. So, all right. So, a total figure of $900,000, which would represent
so that we could have around $1 million left over.
Additional $700,000 from what is already proposed in the budget. Mr. Fisher, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Mr. O'Connor reminds me that the fund balance is the unassigned fund balance. That's the term from the financial standpoint. It's not the undesignated. So we're just trying to keep these to the actual columns that are in your budget and in the audit for the town.
So we're going to call it, with your permission, Mr. Dimes, the unassigned fund balance. Is that all right?
Yes.
So the motion has been made and seconded to amend by appropriating $900,000 from the unassigned fund balance. Are you ready for that question? Ms. Stark.
Billy Stark, District 1. I guess I just would like to remind everyone that you're talking revenue and expenses. When we pass a budget, we're passing an expense budget. Moving $900,000 from the unassigned fund may have an impact on the tax rate, but it does absolutely nothing to the budget. So next year we'll be in worse shape. So I think you need to think about apples and apples versus apples and oranges, because just using up the unassigned fund does absolutely nothing to reduce the budget. So if you want a reduction in the budget, you need to call for a reduction in the budget expenses. Thank you.
Further discussion on Mr. Dimes' motion to appropriate $900,000 from the unassigned fund balance. Mr. Wilmerding.
I think it's apropos to this discussion that the Representative Town Meeting Finance Committee spent its first few months convening in the past three-year period. This would have been in 2011 and part of 2012, debating whether we should have a policy on maintaining a minimum amount of money in the unassigned fund balance. Some people call it the rainy day fund, some people call it the surplus. The unassigned fund balance terminology is used to formalize the concept a little bit so that people can discuss it and decide what to do with it. And owing to our studies of the matter, as I recall, we found that it's conventional wisdom in public administration to keep it at least 10% of your annual budget in unassigned fund balance in case of emergencies. And we have the very recent experience of Hurricane Irene, Tropical Storm Irene, to remind us that we were able to take care of immediate needs because we had a certain amount of money in reserve because of precisely the fact that we had an unassigned fund balance. Our recommendation as a finance committee to the select board was that a policy be instituted to have the unassigned fund balance not fall below a certain amount. The select board, and I think they were correct in this, said, well, we are sympathetic with the idea of this, but we can't regard it as a policy. I think actually it would be Representative Town Meeting that would have to establish such a policy. But it seems to me that if we're going to just sort of decide to spend it down to 5% or 4% as a result of this exigency now, that sort of flies in the face of a lot of hard work that we did in the Finance Committee and the Select Board has done in doing due diligence to trying to figure out how much money we should keep in that fund.
Further discussion? Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Jill Stahl, Tyler, I'm not sure Stahl. Which district, school board. Just a question to all of you. I understand that when we had the rain and we washed out the one road, that was a lot of money. I'm wondering how much we have, how much already out there that we know we have to fix in the municipal building, just so that all of the rest of us out here that aren't used to seeing those numbers have an idea of how much, what can happen with one snowstorm. Hurricane Irene, I think all of us kind of hope that never, well, we definitely hope it never happens again, but we kind of put it in our head as a natural disaster. But some of these other things actually happen much more regularly. Some numbers.
Is there a member of the administration that can respond to Ms. Stahl-Tyler's question?
It costs $92,000 to repair Elm Street after those September 11th, 2013 storms. It cost $57,500 to move the equipment from Wantastiket to the ski jump and the smokestack there at the hospital. And it looks like it's going to cost us $450,000, if I recall correctly, to do the work that the state labor and industry has said needs to be done at Town Hall. So that's just an example of some expenses that arise sort of unexpectedly.
Mr. Webster? The question is on the Dimes motion to amend.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Don Webster, District 3. I'm not going to discuss surpluses. I remember supporting using a modest use of the surplus as given the size of it, and I have serious reservations whether the national standard of 10% is appropriate or not, but that could be certainly determined in the future by the board and the committee, as John mentions. But I do look at a couple of things that I've heard tonight. One was that nobody in District 1 supports this budget. I know people in District 1 that support this budget. I have some that don't. But in other words, I think the opposition to any kind of increase is overstated, and many, many people would like to have a modest budget passed that's less than the one before. And I look at this thing, and it says 2.87% increase. I don't know what the inflation rate is now, but it's about that. So to me, this is a very responsible budget. It's reduced it significantly, and the voters, by and large, will support it. Thank you.
The question before you is on the dime motion to amend to appropriate $900,000 from the unassigned fund balance. Are you ready for that vote, Mr. Fennell?
Tom Fennell, District 3. Earlier, I spoke on behalf of what I will call the lesser landlords in my district, and they're concerned with being able to continue owning their houses. This particular amendment tends to help those guys, so I just want to put in a word saying that I support it for that reason.
Further discussion on the Mr. Maima. Yes.
Ralph Maima, District 3. I just have a question that I'd like cleared up. So in the proposed budget, the property tax would increase 2.87%. But I'm just wondering if someone could explain whether that is simply one layer of several other tax increases that would result in a larger total, a larger net tax increase for property owners. Because I understand that there are also some state fees or taxes that get passed through, and there's also an increase in the water and sewer costs for homeowners. So if someone could just explain what the whole stack looks like and what the entire resulting property tax or property owners' costs look like, that would be much appreciated.
Is there a point of order in the back? Ms. Erfer.
With all due respect to Ralph, I don't think that's actually germane because we're speaking to Kurt's amendment about the $900,000. So that is probably perfectly fine to bring up once we get this question done. Is that correct?
Well, I think, Ms. Erfer, you are correct. However, he's already posed the question, so let's not retread that path if we can help. Is there someone within the administration that can answer Mr. Maima's question? Mr. Moreland.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Maima. As you can see, the increase being proposed here, you see, is a 2.87% increase. Just above that, you've got the cent increase, which is just a little bit above 3.25 cents. To that, there is also, obviously, the school portion. This just relates to the municipal portion. The school portion is estimated to be about 7 cents. So what you'd be looking at there is about 10.25 cent tax increase. The other point that you made related to utility rates, which is true, there was ordinance passed for utility rates for ratepayers, which are different than property taxpayers. And that was, I believe, 2% on the water and 6% on the wastewater, if I'm not mistaken. But that again, that's separate from your taxes.
Yes, Mrs. Melton.
Can we do anything about that ban? It's really loud.
Is there someone here who... knows whether we can do anything about the fan? We will check. In the meantime, can we continue with the debate on Mr. Dimes's motion? Is there further debate or further discussion with regard to his motion to amend? Ms. Russell.
Lynn Russell, District 1. while I agree with Billy Stark's comment about reducing expenses is not going to change the budget. Reducing the budget for this year by that amount gives the town then a full year to restructure the whole process, the whole dilemma that we face. And so I encourage the body to vote yes to the amendment. Is that really what I'm asking? Anyway, to vote with in mind the people of lesser means. There are about 60% of households in Brattleboro living below a livable wage. They are impacted the most. As Tom Fennell remarked earlier, and I would like us all to be taking care of everybody and putting our best efforts toward restructuring the whole thing in this ensuing year. Thank you.
It's the green circuit. You can shut it off, but then it's totally dead air.
Okay. All right, I'm told that we can shut it off, but what's going to happen is we will have no air whatsoever. So it's... That might be a good idea. Mr. Scholes.
I want to clarify on Ralph Newman's question about the additional taxes. The town elementary schools, which is what you voted on in March, if you recall, it was up less than 1% and would probably add a penny or so to the tax rate. The state property tax is 4 cents. They were talking about 7 cents for a long time. I believe they settled on 4 cents. And I don't know what the high school property, the high school's tax will be or what that will add. But again, those are not things that we vote on. But the school tax that you vote on, which is the elementary schools in Brattleboro, is up less than 1%.
Mr. Barber.
Orion Barber, District 1. I don't think I like the idea of pulling $900,000 out of the unassigned fund balance, but I'd like somebody to tell me what will that leave in the unassigned fund balance. I don't want to be in a place where we have no place to go and when the next disaster happens.
Mr. Moreland is interrogated.
Mr. Barber, we anticipate that that would leave us with $1 million. Excuse me. We anticipate that that would leave us with $1 million in the unassigned fund balance. 800? Forgive me. 800,000.
800,000. I'm going to vote against this.
All the way in the back.
Jim Verzino, District 3. I'd like to call the question.
Mr. Verzino has called the question. That requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of ceasing debate, please rise. You may be seated. All those opposed to ceasing debate, please rise. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. You may be seated. And you have voted to cease debate. And we return now to the Dimes question. Your vote that you're about to take is on Mr. Dimes' motion to appropriate $900,000 from the unassigned fund balance. All those in favor of that motion, please rise. You may be seated. All those opposed, please rise. You may be seated, and you have defeated the Dimes motion, and we return to the principal motion made by Mr. Gartenstein on the budget to raise, appropriate, and expend the sum not to exceed $15,666,866. Are you ready for that vote? I think it's Ms. Southworth.
Jane Southworth, District 2. I'm going to vote, although it's a difficult vote, but I talked to a large number of people in my neighborhood and around town, and I'm going to vote for the revised budget. Of the people I talked to, 90% about believe that enough progress has been made on reducing a budget which all of them agreed was too high. However, further reductions in town expenses and taxes are affected not just by the town budget, but also, as we know, by the town school and the high school budget. All the town reps and anyone else who is concerned, as we all ought to be, should try to be involved in all the budgets, each of which impacts the taxes. In addition, I have perceived in our discussions and controversy that many residents do not feel represented by our representative town meeting, and I hope that all of us, all 140 plus minus reps, will, as we go forward, consult with all the people that they can and attend as many budget discussions in all the budget-making institutions in town. Thanks.
The question is, shall the select board be authorized to raise, appropriate, and expend the sum not to exceed $15,666,866 in order to defray to that extent all general fund expenses, and that's the abbreviated version of the motion. Are you ready for that question? Ms. Kane.
Mary Kane, District 1. Just since I tend to listen to the people a little bit more than maybe some people do, there's 110 houses on the market right now. 110. That's all economic categories we're talking about, movement. And since I knew eight people at the informational meeting, I now know more than a dozen people that are moving. And there's probably more moving that we haven't yet heard from. And I don't know about you, but I came here knowing or thinking that I could afford to live here for the rest of my life. And that's not the case. Not the case for me, not the case for my children. And so once you decide that this budget is in place, expect that the realtors will be very happy. They'll be very happy, so will the moving companies. But then you'll be forced to have empty houses. And that is something you need to really look at and say, are we ready? I mean, I predicted that the Austin school, who wasn't supported by this town, would have challenges and no one listened. Now look what happened. I'm predicting that we have a problem here of spending, and I don't see it is really stopping. So my hope is that whatever you decide tonight, you realize that you too may be affected, and you too may have to list your house and leave and go somewhere else that doesn't have the taxes that high. Thank you.
Further discussion on the motion? Yes.
Lisa Weinman, District 1. I just wanted to ask a question regarding revenue generation. And it seems like always in these discussions, there's the people who think that Brattleboro is going down and, you know, there's, you know, no bright future. And then there's another side of people who think there is a bright future and that there's a lot going for the town and that we're on an upswing. So it seems like there's a divide in the town that's, you know, pretty obvious. And I wonder, has it come up to try to tap into those who are doing better, to try to, you know, with the property, when you pay your property taxes, to elect to have a 1% increase that those who do have the means can elect to actually pay more for the, and you can earmark such a request specifically for, say, police and fire facilities for the town. Likewise, has it been explored to do a sales, an optional sales tax, where people who, when you're coming to the counter and you're asked, would you like to pay an additional 1% to support Brattleboro's police and fire departments, that you could elect to pay that 1% as you go? Has any of that been explored, is my question. And I would just like to appreciate the work that's been done. I think this revote was largely a vote against the enormity of the police and fire department project, so I appreciate that has been addressed. We still do need the facility and look forward to future discussions on that.
Is there anyone from the administration that would like to respond to Ms. Wyman's comments? Mr. Scholes.
We've had directly to your question about the 1% option, 1% voluntary tax and philanthropic contributions. We've had some suggestions and proposals and some volunteers. And I would encourage you to contact Eli Gould or Chris Chapman and help them explore that.
Further discussion on the motion? All the way in the back. Dr. Slawinski, I think, isn't that? Can't quite see. Yes, it is.
I supported the budget that was proposed back in March with the understanding that if the money was not spent for the police and fire department as been outlined, that in fact it would incur greater expense in the future. In other words, that by trying to decrease the budget at this point would perhaps be penny wise and pound foolish, that we would be faced with the prospect, we inevitably will be faced with the prospect of a police and fire department that will be of substantial expense, and if we put off that expense, it will actually be more expensive in the long run. Do I understand this correctly, or could somebody speak to that, please?
Is there a member of the administration that would like to respond to Dr. Slawinski's comments? Mr. Scholes.
The construction costs just generally go up. Interest rates bounce around, but if you put something off, it always costs more later on. I don't think there's any question about that. The other thing is when things get cut or reduced, like if you reduce your roofing from a 50-year life expectancy to 30-year life expectancy, that means you're going to be spending money on it. The same with windows and doors. There's different quality, and if you have to reduce your costs, those are the things that you cut. Things like furniture, which seems like, oh, gee, just furniture. But when you build a new facility, you're also putting in all new technology, all new electrical, all new wiring. And if the furniture doesn't fit, if you bring in the old furniture, then you've got extension cords all over the place. You've got things that don't fit, obsolete equipment. And that winds up going into the regular budget so that you pay for it over a longer period of time, but you still pay for it, as opposed to buying and designing it and buying it to fit and work most efficiently. So those are some of the ways that the cost is increased.
Mr. Phillips.
Steve Phillips, District 3. So I'm going to support this budget. I commend the Select Board for their thoughtful dedication of time to this effort. Having said that, I just want to point out that the rate of increase in our budget is still unacceptably high. And so we've got a couple of figures. One that says our tax rate is going to go up 2.87%. We've got another one that says our budget is going up 6.4%. So I think the 6.4, I'd rather take the 2.87 if I had my choice. So what this must mean is that there's either other revenue or the grand list is going up. And I wonder if you can address that, because I do think that 6.4 year after year is still not going to be sustainable. And we've got to do tougher work, and I know the board will be up to it. If you can answer that discrepancy, that would be really helpful. Thank you.
Is there a member of the administration that can respond to Mr. Phillips' inquiry?
The FY14 budget of 14,923,357 that you're using for comparison, or that we use for comparison to the 15, total 15,881,866, and I understand Mr. Siegel's concerns about that, does not account for the $765,000 that we spent last year from the reserve fund. So our budget last year was 14,9, or our expenditures were 14,923,357 plus 765, which is money that we transferred from the savings account last year. This year we're transferring less money from the savings account. It's the $200,000 from the unassigned fund balance and the about 320 that's left over from the skating rink.
Last year was a culprit.
Well, it's not last year it was a culprit. It's just that there's been a steady increase in the budget personnel, and we took out part of the police fire bond.
Further discussion on the budget? You've already spoken, Mr. Wilmerding, but we will allow you, since nobody, no one else wishes to speak, 2 more minutes.
Just a point of explanation. We have looked into this question as your finance committee, and if you had a level funded budget, you would have a reduction in services, because there are certain categories of expense that are scheduled for increase, such as health insurance, that will increase no matter what. So this is why the budget is more each year. It's because certain kinds of expenses do go up that we have no control over.
Further discussion on the budget. Are you ready for the question? If so.
Mr. Moderator?
Yes, Mr. Dimes.
I request a roll call. I think the people will want to know who votes which way on this issue.
Yes, Mr. Schultz.
Maybe it's not quite a word. I'm not sure what it is, but I wonder
Microphone and stand up.
I know, I'm used to it. I wonder if a division might serve the same purpose.
Mr. Dimes, would you let, first of all, a roll call requires 6 members requesting it. Mr. Dimes is one. But the question is, Mr. Dimes, would you be satisfied if it was a division as opposed to a roll call?
I would, but I don't think the public would. I think the public wants to know who votes which way.
Are there 6 members who would like to see a roll call? Please rise. I have 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We've got 6 members. We will have a roll call. The question again, while we're preparing the roll call, while the clerk is preparing, is the selectmen be authorized to raise, appropriate, and expend the sum not to exceed $15,666,866 in order to defray to that extent all general fund expenses for the period of July 1st, 2014 through June 30th, 2015, including all highways and Windham County taxes, and the select board be authorized to expend in addition any sums authorized for special purposes under any article contained in the warning for this meeting, the annual meeting, or any other special meeting, and interest at the rate of 1% per month to be charged from the due date of payment on any overdue payment of the town tax, installment or portion thereof, and that the town taxes assessed on the grand list as of April 1, 2014, shall be due and payable in 4 equal installments payable to the town treasurer until overdue, then to the collector of taxes, and that such payment of the installments shall be made on or before 5 p.m. August 15, 2014, and November 17, 2014, and February 17, 2015, and May 15th, 2015, and I give you to the clerk for the roll call.
Okay, I will read off your name, and if you will say yay or nay. And as you do, my assistant Jane will record it. She'll say check when she has it, and then I'll go on to the next name. So, everybody ready? Marion Abel.
Nay.
Peter Abel.
Nay.
Spoon Agave.
Yay.
John Allen.
Yay.
Kate Anderson.
Yay.
Robert Beatty.
Yay.
Linda Bailey. Okay. Rebecca Ballant.
Yay.
Brian Bannon.
Yay.
Carol Barber.
Yay.
Orion. Oh, sorry. Carol Barber again, please. Yay. Yay. Orion Barber.
Yay.
John Bixby. Not here. Mary Ellen Bixby. Okay. Carol Lee Bluen. Evan Bolivar. Donna Borofsky.
Yay.
Stanley Borofsky.
Yay.
Michael Bosworth.
Yay.
Hugh Bronson. No? Okay. Sally Brunton.
Yay.
Molly Burke.
Yay.
George Burroughs.
Yay.
William Bushy. David Cadran. Mary Kane.
No.
Annette Cappy. Yay. Gary Carrier.
Yay.
Philip Chapman.
Yay.
Alice Sharks.
Yay.
Diane Cook.
Yay.
Richard Cook.
Yay.
Peter Cooper.
Yay.
Mary Copans. Stuart Copans. Douglas Cox.
Yay.
Lauren Crisp. Skip, okay. Charles Cummings.
Yay.
Lucinda Cuthbertson.
Nay.
Kurt Dimes.
Nay.
Judith Davidson.
Yay.
Andrew Davis.
Yay.
Arlene Disler.
Yay.
Catherine Dowd.
Yes.
Mary Elder. Not here. Timothy Ellis. Corwin Elwell.
Yay.
Elizabeth Elwell, I don't think she's here either. Bob Everingham.
Yay.
Arden Fagelson. Neither one are? Okay. We'll skip Robert Fagelson too. R. Michael Fairchild.
Yay.
Peter Fallion.
Yay.
Anthony Farnham.
Yay.
Thomas Fennell.
No.
Thomas Franks.
Yay.
Douglas Franz. I'm sorry, I didn't catch it either. Douglas Franz?
Yay.
David Gartenstein?
Yay.
Elizabeth Gentile?
Yay.
Virginia Goodman?
Yay.
Eli Gould?
Yay.
Julia Grover?
Yay.
Elwin Hamilton? Not here. Sean Hammond? George Harvey? Helene Henry? George Herzog.
Yay.
Beth Heiner.
Yay.
Gregory Howe.
Yay.
Lisa Johnson.
Yay.
You can get that, okay. Veronica Johnson.
Yes.
Jean Keywell.
Yay.
Judith Kinley.
Yay.
James Kirby.
Yay.
Louise Knutson's not here. Doris Lake.
Yay.
Alice Landsman. Juanita Lane.
Yay.
Richard Langlois.
Yay.
Sylvia Lyon.
Yay.
Prudence McKinney.
Yay.
Donna McComber.
Yay.
Lee Madden.
Yes.
Sherry Manning.
Yay.
Frederick Manson. Not here. Mary McCarthy.
Yay.
Elizabeth McLaughlin.
Yay.
Mary McLaughlin.
Yay.
Ralph Mema.
Yay.
Paula Melton.
Yay.
Nancy Miller.
Yay.
Roger Miller.
Yes.
Tad Montgomery.
Yay.
Anne Moore O'Dell.
Yay.
Alexander Mueller. Muller? Okay. Stephen Nelson.
Yay.
Dennis Newman.
Yes.
Frederick Noyes.
Yay.
John O'Connor.
Yay.
Kathleen O'Connor.
Yay.
Timothy O'Connor.
Yay.
Sandra Page.
Yay.
Sarah Page.
Yay.
William Pearson.
Yay.
Again, please.
Yay.
William Penniman.
Yay.
Stephen Phillips.
Yes.
Joseph, oh, did you get it? Okay. Joseph Pino.
Yay.
Kimberly Price. Okay. George Reed Savory.
Yay.
Charles Robb Sr.
Yay.
George Roberge Jr. Okay. Paul Rounds. Stephen Rowell.
Yes.
Robert Reuter.
Yes.
Lynn Russell.
No.
Raphael Solomon.
Yes.
Leo Schiff.
Yay.
David Scholes.
Yay.
Ann Senny.
Yay.
Hyman Siegel.
Yes.
Walter Slawinski.
Yes.
Jane Southworth.
Yes.
Dana Sprague. Okay. Susan Stafirsky.
Yay.
Jill Stahl Tyler.
Yes.
Billy Stark.
Yes.
Douglas Stark.
No.
Joshua Steele. You didn't check in? Lee Stuckey.
Yes.
Was that a yes, Lee?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Carrie Storm. Not here? She was. Carrie Storm? Okay. Eric Strickland.
Yeah.
Jacqueline Stromberg.
Yay.
Valerie Stewart.
Yeah.
David Sullivan.
No.
Tara Sullivan.
Yay.
David Taft. Tristan Tolino.
Yay.
Robert Tolani.
Yay.
Stephen Truhan.
Yay.
Catherine Turnus.
Yay.
Benedict Underhill.
Yay.
Kathy Erfer.
Yay.
Francine Valerio.
Yay.
I'm
sorry.
Francine again? Yes?
Yes.
James Verzino.
Yay.
Donald Webster.
Yay.
Lisa Weinman.
Yes.
Emily Wergen.
Yay.
Marshall Wheelock.
Yes.
Veronica Wheelock.
Yes.
John Wilmerding.
Yes.
Edward Wright.
Yes.
Christine Yost.
Yes.
Peter Yost.
Yes.
And Deborah Zach.
Yes.
Okay. We will add those up. Yep.
Listen to the results of your vote. Yes, 112, and no, 12, and you have adopted Article 1.
Mr. Moderator.
Yes. Mr. Dimes.
Could we have a recount? Just kidding.
Thank you, Mr. Times. We now move to other business, and I would like to take this opportunity to remind the members and also the general public that we have a very important function within town meeting, namely that function of finance committee, that we still need volunteers. We have three or four people that have volunteered already. We do not need, the volunteers need not necessarily be members of town meeting. And if the, anyone in the general public is interested in serving on this important committee, please contact me. My email is CRISP, that's C-R-I-S-P with an E at the end, at sovr.net. And we'll see if we can't get you hooked up with the finance committee. We now go to any other matters that might come before the meeting of a non-binding nature, and I would recognize Mr. Agave.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would like to refer, I think many of you have a sheet in front of you. It was distributed on the back table. It's the motion I shall read. It's at the very top in dark letters, to establish an ad hoc committee of representative town meeting for the purpose of bringing forth a proposal for the establishment of a futures commission. I don't know what exactly it may be called in the end. The ad hoc committee shall create a statement of goals for the commission consistent with this resolution and shall propose bylaws in furtherance of its purpose. The committee shall report back to representative town meeting with its recommendations at town meeting 2015. Members shall apply to and be appointed by the town moderator.
Is there a second to Mr. Agave's motion? It has been moved and seconded to establish an ad hoc committee of representative town meeting for the purpose of bringing forth a proposal for the establishment of a futures commission. The ad hoc committee shall create a statement of goals for the commission consistent with this resolution and shall propose bylaws in furtherance of its purpose. The committee shall report back to representative town meeting with its recommendations at town meeting 2015. Members shall apply to and be appointed by the town moderator. Mr. Agave, do you wish to speak to the motion?
Yes, I would like to, thank you. I have right under it some of my thoughts about why it's important, and then I also provided at the end, actually, another much more professionally written description and explanation of what such a commission would do that was created in a much larger municipality. Well, it's not a municipality, it's a county of 318,000 people. They actually established their futures commission in 1988. The point is that we have enormously complex problems in the town. I think much of what has occurred over the last few months certainly points to a lot of them. The economic strife, the problems, the future is very, very uncertain. There are questions all over about whether our town governance, the structure, is adequate at the moment to confront, to deal with all the problems we have. Our charter was written in 1959. In 1959, the world looked a lot different. There's also a lot of questions about the relationship between the schools and the town. There's a lot of questions about energy and climate change and jobs, economics, and all sorts of things. These are enormously complex questions that require a lot of thought and a lot of work, a lot of reading, a lot of discussion. And there really isn't a place in the town currently that can do this work, that can address those questions. We have a town plan, but a town plan is essentially a land use planning document. You put a town plan into effect by writing zoning laws. And it does not address all the larger interconnected historical, cultural, et cetera, issues. And I'm not sure even if it wanted to, it would have the capability. And it's a task we certainly couldn't ask of the five members of the select board. I feel I have a hunch that they feel they already have enough hours in that job. And so I don't know where else. I don't think the town is in a position that it could hire some firm full of experts in this field to actually help us with it. And I think there's a lot to be said for us doing this ourselves with all the help we can get. So that's it in a large nutshell. And one thing, as you think about this for a moment, try to distinguish, and this will be a little bit hard. I had a lot of advice that said, don't go for the interim step of the ad hoc committee, go directly for the commission itself. And I really thought that over for a long time. But I feel like the commission has a lot of questions to answer, and I list a few of them. How long it should last, how it should report, when it should report, is there any money involved, da 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 da. I can't answer all those. I couldn't bring a proposal to you that could answer all those. And I feel like we should set up the body that we want, or this commission, as we want it to look. So when you're thinking about questions right now, I can't answer what the futures commission itself will look like. Right now, this is just getting an ad hoc committee to create that commission.
Is there discussion with regard to Mr. Agavi's motion? Mr. Womerding.
John Wilmerding, 2nd District. I strongly support this. I think it's an example of an individual coming forward on his own initiative with his own imagination and his own leadings. I've worked with him for 3 years on the Finance Committee with him as chair. I've often felt in the Finance Committee that we had to look at larger questions. What are the larger trends that are going to affect our ability to spend money and provide services in the town? Will oil costs keep going up? Will we have to go completely to renewable energy? Click yay, yay, yay. I looked very carefully at a lot of these concerns. In the Finance Committee, we have trouble sometimes getting beyond dollars and cents in budgets. I hope that the body will look upon this proposal favorably, and I think that implicit in it is an offer by Mr. Agavi to help convene that committee.
Further discussion? Yes. Ms. Turnus.
Catherine Turnus, District 3. I do support Spoon in this endeavor. I find it interesting that we have a community that has so many diversified people that have knowledge of what is needed for this possible ad hoc committee and a commission. We do not have to go outside our community. And as it was presented before, we don't need another feasibility study. So we really do need to get something like this going. I was on the Finance Committee for 2 years, and I can agree with John that there's the limits that we were looking at the budgets. This would even give us a greater insight on where the future holds for Brattleboro.
Mr. Fallon?
Peter Valiant, District 3. I I too support this wholeheartedly, this move. I'd like to just get back to what I was saying earlier in the meeting, that in order for us to solve our economic problems, we have to have many, many, many more people in the room, around the table, figuratively speaking. And this idea of a commission, it seems to me, would lend itself very effectively to bringing other very key voices and key players in economic development, job development. We know who these groups are and these people. Because of the way we're structured as a body, we don't hear that perspective, now those points of view, enough or at all. So this commission seems to me might lend itself to being a forum for a very important narrative that we absolutely have to have moving forward. Thanks.
Mr. Cummings, did you have your hand up?
Yes,
on another issue.
That I want to make another issue.
Oh, sorry. Any other, Mr. Fennell, comments on this particular motion of Mr. Agave?
Tom Fennell, District 3. I see people leaving the room. I don't hear anybody opposing to this. I'd like to call a question.
Mr. Fennell has moved to suspend debate. Is there a second? All those in favor of suspending debate, which requires a two-third vote, please rise. You may be seated. All those opposed to suspending debate, please rise. You may be seated. The ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. And you have suspended the debate on the Agave motion. And we return to the motion. And the motion is to establish an ad hoc committee of representative town meeting for the purpose of bringing forth a proposal for the establishment of a futures commission. The ad hoc committee shall create a statement of goals for the commission consistent with this resolution and shall propose bylaws in furtherance of its purpose. The committee shall report back to representative town meeting with its recommendations at town meeting 2015. Members shall apply to and be appointed by the town moderator. All those in favor of the motion, please rise. You may be seated. All those opposed, please rise. And you have almost unanimously approved Mr. Agave's resolution. Is there further business to come before the meeting, Mr. Cummings?
Very briefly, it has been alluded by a speaker tonight that Austin School is closing because of lack of support of the town. That is not true, and I would hate to have it go out of this room as fact. It is not fact.
Further comment, discussion? Hearing none, do I hear a motion to adjourn? Is there a second? All those in favor of adjourning, kindly rise. You may be seated, all those opposed. And you have adjourned this meeting at 8:25 p.m.